need to be sorry for anything.
Good evening, everyone. Today, in our cycle of seminars and conferences, our welcome guest is Charles Barstow. He's from Vermont in the northeastern United States. He studied anthropology as an undergraduate and then spent 4 years working as a butcher and vegetable farmer before moving to Italy to obtain a master's degree in gastronomy at UNISC. His thesis, advised by Professor Paola Migliorini, was about the diversity of weeds growing in association with different varieties of organically cultivated wheat. During his time at UNISC, Charles also carried out ethnobiological research among the Moroccan community in Bra. After graduation, Charles worked for Slow Food, where he oversaw the Arc of Taste project. That summer, he returned to the United States to begin PhD studies in cultural anthropology at the University of Florida. His research now focuses on the relationships between biocultural diversity, traditional knowledge, and conservation. Thank you very much, Charles Barstow, for accepting our invitation, and I give you the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Antonella. Thank you for inviting me to speak. And thanks to everybody who's here and to everyone who will maybe watch the recording. I hope that folks who wanna watch will have the opportunity to do so. So I'm gonna share a presentation. I've tried to make this presentation mostly visual in hopes that that'll be more interesting than just reading text. Antonelle, can you confirm that you can see the first slide?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I'm going to talk today about some of the general areas of interest and research that underlie my own personal research agenda for my graduate studies. I've only just completed my first year of my PhD, so it's still very early days, and I haven't actually begun my research yet in earnest. I'm hoping to conduct my research in the Himalayas, and for obvious reasons, traveling to India and Nepal at the moment is not feasible. So I haven't been able to start my fieldwork yet. But I'm just going to share with you some of the things that I've become interested in over the past few years, including when I was a master's student in Pollenzo in 2016-17. And then some of the things that I learned about there grew more as I worked on the Arc of Taste and got to know different people throughout the Slow Food Network and did research on my own. So that's all sort of fed into what I'm doing now. And so I'm just going to tell you a bit about that. And what I'm talking about is not directly related to food, although it's related very much to human subsistence and the ways that people interact with the environment. So it's indirectly very relevant to food, and you may find that it's more or less relevant to your own interests and things that you might want to pursue in the future. So the title of my presentation is Biodiversity is an Artifact, or How People Make Ecosystems. So just at a very basic level, what is biodiversity? This is something that you've maybe discussed in classes at Pollenzo. Biodiversity is obviously a very important theme for slow food. And very simply, it just means the diversity of life at all levels and scales and the totality of that diversity. So basically, biodiversity is spoken about at three major levels. The first, the smallest level is genes. So genetic diversity would be the diversity within a given species. In the case of this photograph here, these are different varieties of rice that are grown by a slow food presidium in India. So this would be intra-specific diversity. Then there's diversity at the level of species. And that could be everything from the microorganisms that give blue cheese its blue color to insects such as these honeybees, which are obviously a crucial part of any ecosystem in which they're found, to very large organisms such as this araucaria tree, which is a tree from Brazil that produces a nut, which is also harvested in the context of a slow food presidium. And you can maybe see, although the image might be too small, that there's a person in the middle of that tree to give you a sense of how large it is. So again, here we have, even within the level of species, there's a massive range in the scale of the organisms that we're talking about. And then finally, on the largest, most spatially and physically extensive level, there's the biodiversity of ecosystems. And this particular image is a photograph that I took a few summers ago when I was on a research trip with Slow Food in Borneo, one of the major islands of Indonesia and Malaysia. And this is on the Indonesian side of the island in the highlands. And this is a swidden, otherwise known as a slash and burn field in its first year. So you can see the remains of some burned stumps. And then there's a whole range of different edible plants growing in that swidden. And then you can see on the edges, there's the forest. So this is a human influenced ecosystem, which contains biodiversity at both the genetic and species levels, and itself makes up part of the biodiversity of the ecosystem level in that region. So the other important word in the title of my talk is artifact. I want to talk a little bit about what that means. So basically, an artifact is just anything that's made by humans, made or modified by humans. So this could be something as small as an object. It could be a structure or some aspect of the built environment, or it could in fact be an entire landscape. And when we get to the level of landscapes, some people use the word ecofact, which is just a variation on the idea of artifact, but having to do with natural substances. So one definition, which is given by Kirch, is that an ecofact is the detritus of everyday life, such things as plant remains of all kinds, animal bones and shells, as well as inanimate objects, including soil and sediments. These types of things can also be referred to as biofacts. And then another sense in which to think about an ecofact is just as the landscape as a whole, if that landscape has been influenced in some way by human activity, whether indirectly or as the result of some sort of intentional change. So Oyuela Caicedo, who's one of my professors at the University of Florida, has an article called "The Forest as a Fragmented Archaeological Artifact," and he's looking there at an entire landscape as an ecofact. And then there's the concept of an anthropogenic landscape or ecosystem. And that's simply any place sort of on the landscape level or even more broadly that's been altered or modified to some degree, which may be very small or maybe almost complete by humans. So an anthropogenic landscape just means a human-made landscape. So this is one example of an anthropogenic landscape. This is a photograph that I took in the Garfagnana Valley, which is in the northwestern part of Tuscany. It's an area that used to be more heavily populated and farmed than it is now. These are sort of some remnant terraces on the side of the valley, and there are chestnut trees growing there. These trees have been managed over many years. They're not that heavily managed anymore, but you can tell by their growth form that they were pruned over the years to encourage them to grow in a certain way and to produce a more abundant crop of chestnuts. So this is an example of an anthropogenic landscape from Italy. This is a piece of an anthropogenic landscape from my home state of Vermont in New England in the northeastern United States, which is actually where I am right now. And that's a road in the forest with a row of sugar maple trees growing along the left side separating the road from a meadow. That meadow is a hay meadow. It is not used for growing crops or for pasturing livestock, but it's been there for many generations. And the sugar maples that grow between the road and the field are used as a source of maple sap, with which maple syrup and maple sugar are made. So this is a landscape, the composition of which is due basically entirely to human activity and human needs. And then finally, returning to the highlands of central Borneo, this is part of the village of Binuang, where I went for my slow food field visit. And this is a series of rice paddies. And so clearly you can see here the imprint of human activity on the landscape and the fact that it has contributed to the biodiversity, because obviously there are things growing there that would not be if it weren't for humans. So another very important concept for my research is biocultural diversity. And this basically refers to a phenomenon which this map illustrates sort of from one perspective. Biocultural diversity just refers to the idea that biological diversity and then the diversity of human cultures and ways of life overlap and interact in various different ways. And so what this map is showing is, on the one hand, you have the green shading. And so the darker greenish-gray areas are areas that have high plant diversity. So here, plant diversity is being used as a proxy for biodiversity, generally speaking. And then on the other hand, you have these little white dots or clusters, and the more dense those clusters are, the more languages are spoken in that area. So languages here are being used as a proxy for cultural diversity. And what you see quite clearly is that there's a very strong correlation between high biological diversity as measured through plants and high cultural diversity as measured through languages. So this is a pattern that's been observed and documented in different ways at various geographical scales. But the question that remains and which people are studying is, why does this correlation exist? And so we can look at some different patterns. This is South Asia, the Indian subcontinent. The image on the left shows rainfall. That's the shading. So the darker blue areas have high rainfall every year. And then the red dots are languages, again, sort of as a proxy measure for cultural diversity. And so here again, you see high rainfall corresponds with high cultural diversity as measured by languages. And then the image on the right is showing slope with the shading. So the dark blue areas have high slope. That doesn't mean high elevation per se. It just means that over any given horizontal distance, you'll have a lot of slope. So again, mountainous areas or areas that have a lot of topographical relief correspond very strongly with high densities of different languages. Here in the case of Africa, we have bioproductivity and languages. Bioproductivity is measured here by evapotranspiration. So that's a combination of all of the evaporation that takes place over the annual cycle and all of the transpiration or moisture released by plants. And you can see that it's highest with this darker shading here in the tropical forest region of Central Africa, which would be expected because rainforests, because they're not seasonal forests, they're breathing out moisture the full year. And bioproductivity tends to be highly correlated to high evapotranspiration and to high biodiversity, and as we can see here, to high linguistic diversity or ethno-linguistic diversity. And then this is showing the relationship between cultural diversity, again measured by languages in these red areas, with an anthropogenic feature, namely roads. So the darker areas on this map are areas with a higher density of roads, and the lighter areas have fewer roads. So you can see here that there's an inverse correlation between roads, which can basically be thought of as a proxy for human infrastructure or urbanization, and linguistic or cultural diversity. And then finally, this is a map of lights that appear at night. So again, sort of a proxy measure for urbanization. That's all the little white areas. You can sort of, you can see the map of Europe there in the center and North America on the right. So again, we have an inverse correlation between urbanization and cultural diversity as measured by languages, which are the green blotches. So the question here again is, we see this pattern, but what's the process or the mechanism that underlies this pattern? So we want to move from a correlation to explaining the causality, if indeed there is one. And in all likelihood, the causality is not a one-way causality. There's probably influences in multiple directions. So humans influencing the biodiversity of their landscapes, and biodiversity influencing sort of what humans are able to do in different parts of the world. So if we look at the two images, the one that has roads versus languages and the one that has night lights versus languages, so the expectation might sort of be that, you know, where there are people in high concentrations, there's less biological and cultural diversity. And this image here on the right is just an aerial view of Tokyo, which is, as you know, the largest, the most populous city on Earth. And that represents sort of one extreme of the spectrum. We might think of it not even as an ecosystem, because it's basically entirely human-made. It's the sort of most extreme example of an anthropogenic environment that we could think of. But of course, it is an ecosystem. And the inverse of that is that even the places that we think of as being the most wild or natural or untouched by humans are in fact, in virtually every case, influenced to some degree by people, or bear the trace of human presence or modification at some point in time. And the fact that we now know that there are microplastics in the very deepest reaches of our oceans, it's just one example of the idea that that our presence and our activities have an impact and an influence on every place on this planet to one degree or another. So a landscape with which you guys are familiar and which we might think of as more natural or less anthropogenic is Barolo. So this is the Barolo wine region. The town that you can see in the upper left of the left-hand image is La Mora, and then this is just a photograph of the vineyards. And so here we would say, yeah, this is more natural. It's full of plants, obviously, but it's also very clear that it's a human-made landscape. What you see on the landscape is a result of human activity over many centuries. So this is sort of somewhere in the middle of the spectrum. It's not a wild forest, it's not a city, but it falls somewhere in between. So I'm going to show you some examples now of anthropogenic landscapes in places that are sometimes stereotypically thought of as being less urban, less human influenced, more wild, more natural. So this West Africa, see Guinea, Sierra Leone, Liberia, Cote d'Ivoire. And basically, ecologically, as you move from closer to the equator in the south, you have forest, and then you transition to savanna as you move north into higher latitudes. And then eventually, if you kept going north off the image, you would move into the Sahel and then the Sahara Desert. And this all has to do basically with rainfall. So areas that have higher rainfall are able to support forests, and then as annual rainfall decreases, the richness and density of plant life also decreases. And between the forest and the savanna, there's what's called the forest savanna mosaic or the forest savanna transition zone. And if we zoom in on this, you can see that there are these little dots or what are called forest islands. So within the what's largely a wooded savanna, there are these little patches of forest, and you can see that in the center of each one is a light dot, and that is a settlement or a village. This is a spot satellite image from 1992. It appears on the cover of a book from 1996 by two anthropologists, James Fairhead and Melissa Leach. And they researched this area in the 90s. This is in the Kisirugu Prefecture of Guinea. And they wanted to understand why the landscape looks the way it does, why these forest islands are there. And the assumption dating back to colonial times was that the landscape had originally been completely forested, and that over time, the local inhabitants had degraded the forest, cut it down, and only left it around their villages to supply various foods and building materials, etc. But it turns out that, in fact, were it not for the presence of humans on this landscape, it would actually be a savanna. So people have actually extended the forest north into the savanna, and these forest islands are not remnants, they're actually, they're human created. And so when a new settlement is established, people plant trees around it, and then as they eat food and discard the seeds and their waste acts as fertilizer, the forest islands around the villages grow and become denser and more full of different kinds of tree species. And so they harbor high levels of biodiversity, as well as providing food, obviously, a cooling effect on the microclimate. They act as fire breaks so that when there are fires on the savanna, the villages are protected by the forests that surround them. They provide building materials, and they provide defense as well. When this area was colonized, people retreated into the villages in these forest islands, and many of them were basically impenetrable to the colonizing forces. So the forest islands have a whole host of different uses, both ecological and sort of socioeconomic. And so contrary to the long-held assumption that Africans were backward primitive people who degraded the landscape, this is in fact an anthropogenic landscape in which people are responsible to some degree. You can argue over how direct or indirect it is, but are responsible for the presence of these little islands of biodiversity. This is just a further zoom in so that you can see the forest island with the village at its center. So there's a similar pattern that you can observe on the other side of the African continent in Ethiopia. So here we're in the north of Ethiopia in the region of South Gondar. And the image on the right shows again the presence of forest islands. Although in this case, it is likely that this region was formerly covered in forest. This is a wetter region. It's more mountainous and receives higher precipitation. So it's likely that these forest islands are in fact remnants of a previous forest rather than being human-created forests in what would otherwise be a grassland ecosystem. But the question is, why are these forest islands here? Why have they persisted while the rest of the landscape has changed or been degraded or forests have been cut down, et cetera? It turns out that these forest islands in this region of Ethiopia are all associated with churches. Christianity has a very long history in Ethiopia, and there's a unique form of Christianity with its own church in this part of the world. And so at the center of each of these forest islands in this part of Ethiopia, there is a church. And the sort of the spatial pattern and the cluster of buildings in each one is virtually identical from one forest island to the next. Their sizes are also very similar. And even the space between the forest islands is quite consistent. It tends to be a couple of kilometers. I'm getting a question from Penelope. Is it Coptic Orthodox Christianity? I don't remember off the top of my head the name of this particular Christian church. It could be Coptic. I would have to look that up. But if you research Ethiopian church forests, you can find out a lot about this, including about the specific sect. So here is a map of this region. The brown to green shading represents the elevation. So you can see in the center there, the brown area, that's basically a mountain. And then all the little green dots are church forests, or these little forest islands, each of which has a church at its center. And again, these trees, most of them are planted by humans and then maintained over many years, generations, and centuries. And they harbor high levels of biodiversity. They're important for different animal species, as well as for the plants and trees. And people make various different uses of them. So now we're going to move to the Amazon basin in South America, which remains a sort of a popular image of wilderness and of untouched ecosystem. But it's becoming more and more clear through different kinds of research and different kinds of evidence that is not the case, that the Amazon too is very much an anthropogenic landscape. It's a forest that looks the way that it does because of millennia of human use and activity. So this yellow line represents what's called the arc of deforestation, which just refers to the southern and eastern edge of the Amazon, which is where most of the deforestation is occurring, and it's gradually moving northwest, encroaching heavily on the forest. But that forest is not a pristine wilderness. It's not untouched. It's not a place where humans have not had an impact, nor in fact, historically, was it a sparsely populated region. It has actually supported very high densities of people. The population collapse that followed European contact due to mostly disease, but also to outright violent encounters. That population collapse was so dramatic that it caused what's known as the Little Ice Age, which is a period of several centuries from the 15th and 16th up until the 18th and 19th centuries, in which the global temperature cooled rather significantly. And that was because after the population collapse in the Americas, which in some cases was up to 90%, people no longer obviously were using agriculture as much because there weren't as many people. They weren't burning the forest as much to clear space for cultivation. And that decrease in human and agricultural activity meant that forests were able to recolonize cleared areas and savannas, and thus absorb a lot more carbon dioxide from the global atmosphere. So this is an example of the very profound effect that humans in this supposedly sort of undomesticated landscape had many centuries ago, even before the arrival of Europeans, and with them more intensive agricultural techniques, larger populations, urbanization, etc. And in fact, the Amazon in the 20th century has more forest cover than it did before the arrival of Europeans. So before around 1500, a lot of the Amazon basin was actually a mixture of forest and savanna, and those savannas were maintained and kept open again by human activity. So one interesting example of the anthropogenic effects of different human groups on the Amazon vegetation and its composition is the Brazil nut, which is, Brazil nuts come from a very, very large tree, which is distributed throughout the Amazon in sort of an unexpected way. And research has revealed that the distribution of this species in the basin is, again, the result largely of human activity and people planting these trees over many millennia so that they could be used as a source of food. So the trees tend to grow along waterways, which obviously were used for transportation by the civilizations that lived in the Amazon before European conquest. They're also closely associated with, as you can see on the next image here, with Amazonian dark earths or terra preta, which is anthropogenic soil. It's basically soil which is enriched through burning and other methods of enrichment to increase its fertility. This image on the right shows areas in yellow of high densities of anthropogenic soils, so this Amazonian dark earth, and in the orange areas where there have been significant earthworks, so mound building, the creation of ditches, all things which are associated with large and complex, complexly structured populations of people, so monumental structures, basically. And then the black are archaeological sites. So you can see that the archaeological sites tend to correspond also with the waterways. And so this is showing, I would say, two important things. One, the idea which was sort of created by the Russian botanist Nikolai Vavilov, that there are centers of crop diversity is sort of a misrepresentation. Because it turns out that the Amazon is in fact a major center of plant domestication. It's just that domestication occurs along a gradient. In some cases, it's full domestication. In other cases, it's management of wild plants and animal resources. So the fact that we tend to think of like the Near East and the Mediterranean and China and the Andes as the main centers of crop diversity is really because those are the areas that supply the foods that most of humanity now eats. And because those areas, we've known for a long time that they supported large, complex populations and civilizations that had monumental architecture and urbanization, et cetera. And it's only become clear more recently that the Amazon and other tropical forests around the world also supported large human populations who were civilized by, you know, the definition of that rather dubious word that we tend to accept. So it's not as clear or as simple as saying that most of the world's domesticated plants and animals came from just a handful of places, because in fact, many people continue to consume things like manioc, which are native to, in the case of manioc, the New World tropical forests, and in the case of other tubers and root crops, you know, the forests of Central Africa or of Southeast Asia and Oceania. So again, looking here at the pattern of the forest, where it remains and where it's been cleared, there's this area in the Southeast Amazon where there's still an extensive area of forest cover surrounded by deforestation. And the question is, why is that there? This is the upper Xingu River and watershed. And the area that's completely forested corresponds perfectly with Xingu Indigenous Preserve. So this is an area which is under the control of its indigenous peoples. The most predominant tribe in this region is called the Kikuyu. And again, recent research has revealed that these people have a culture that goes back many centuries. The Kikuyu that live there today are the direct descendants of people that lived there during the time of European contact. There aren't as many of them there today as there were 500 years ago, but they still build their villages in similar configurations to their ancestors. So this is a contemporary Kwikuru village in the Upper Xingu region. And this image shows it's it maybe a little bit difficult to see, but there are red lines on the image, and those show earthworks. So berms and ditches that were constructed many centuries ago when this area was more densely populated. And the layout of these settlements, some of which are residential and some of which are more ceremonial, reveals that this civilization had quite complex urban planning that extended over really broad areas of the forest and the wetlands and what was then, in many cases, also open savanna. So there were indeed complex urban populations living in this area. And the fact that it is forested today is due in large part to the management of the management styles and practices of the indigenous people living there, which just goes to show that oftentimes leaving regions in the control and in the hands of indigenous peoples is an effective way to ensure that the ecosystem is not rapidly degraded. So another example of human impacts on the Amazon, this time from the Southwest Amazon in Bolivia. This is an area, again, with savanna, wetlands, and then forest islands, kind of like the ones that we saw in the African examples. This is around a settlement. It's basically a large town in the Bolivian Amazon called Barres. You can see that in the right-hand image. There's the town at the center there. And then the yellow circle shows the location of the left-hand image. And you can see in the center of that image, there is an area of taller trees, which forms a ring. And that is what's called a ring ditch, which is a type of earthworks that's associated mostly with ceremonial uses. And so this region, this particular site had humans on it and modifying it many centuries ago, and there are still people living there today and using the forest and savanna for food production, which is why it has this sort of mosaic of areas that have no forest or mature forest, and then everything in between. And these images come from a paper by Clark Erickson, who's done a lot of research in this area. So this image shows the causeways, which connect forest islands. So again, very large scale infrastructure projects, earthworks, which were carried out centuries or millennia ago. And these canals, or these causeways, were associated with canals. So they provided different kinds of infrastructure for transportation, not only the transportation of people and physical goods, but also the dissemination of information and ideas very rapidly across the landscape, and also supported trees and fishing weirs and agricultural fields. As you can see in this final image, the lines going across the savanna here connect our fishing weirs. So basically they were able to control the flow and retention of water on the landscape in order to harvest fish, which is a very important source of protein. So how does this all relate to conservation? I'm just going to give you one very small example from my home region in Vermont. This is based on some research that I've been doing recently. So this area that this aerial photograph shows is part of the Moosilimu National Recreation Area, which was created in 2006. And it's a small part of the larger Green Mountain National Forest, which was created in the 1930s. And this is just about 20 minutes from where I live and from where I'm speaking to you now. So in this aerial view, you can see there's a lake up at the top that's called Silver Lake. And then running down from the lake, there is a valley called Lester Hollow. And then just to its west, there's a ridge called Chandler Ridge. And so this is part of the National Recreation Area. So it's got hiking trails, snowmobile trails, signs with information. And it's a place where people go to enjoy the outdoors and to camp and et cetera. This is an image of Lester Hollow in the center there. You can see it's just this quite narrow, steep-sided wooded valley with a path running down the middle of it. And then the image on the left is of Silver Lake. So as a protected area, I'm interested in how this place is presented to the public, to the people who use it. And so these are some of the informational placards that you would find if you were in this area. These are up at the top of Silver Lake where there's a campground. And it, they paint a very specific portrait of the values that are associated with this place. So I've just highlighted a few things. A walk on the wild side, Silver Lake's wild inhabitants, a wealth of plant life and wildlife. So there's an emphasis here on natural riches and the wild. And that's not just happenstance. That's a specific choice to highlight these qualities and values. So on another set of signs here, we have a natural haven. And this sign does acknowledge the presence of people, both Native Americans and white settlers, but says, quote, "Perhaps you were drawn here by the lake's beauty or by the opportunities it offers for fishing, recreation, and solitude. You're not the only one attracted to this place. The lake has long been a magnet for humans." So it's painting this picture of a beautiful landscape that people enjoy sort of for its aesthetic values. The sign photographed on the left says, quote, "People have adapted to life in this cool rocky landscape," unquote. And it talks about the fact that archaeologists found the remains of two Native American canoes, dugout canoes at the bottom of the lake. This region was inhabited by the Abenaki before European conquest, and there are still Abenaki in Vermont today, although obviously their population is very small, as is the case for most Native Americans compared to pre-contact times. So the picture that's being painted here again is of a place that's basically natural and humans had to, quote, adapt to it. But it doesn't make any acknowledgement of the fact that people may have shaped and influenced and changed the landscape intentionally in order to make it fulfill different kinds of needs and purposes, including obviously the need for food and shelter and spiritual significance or what have you. And so I've looked in a little bit to what are some of the human traces on this landscape. So this is a clearing from the middle of Lester Hollow. And those two trees that you see in the center are apple trees. Apple trees are very closely associated with people. Apples were brought to North America by European colonists. And they quickly proliferated across much of North America. And today you find apples growing, at least around where I live, you find them virtually everywhere, sometimes in the forest, very often along meadows and farm fields, or in the clearings where power lines run across the landscape. They prefer edge habitats and open areas. And most of them that you find growing outside of orchards are they're the descendants of apple trees that were planted intentionally by people. And today, many of them are no longer managed or harvested, but they are a part of the landscape. They're part of the ecosystem. They provide habitat and food for all kinds of animals, everything from bees to deer. So these apple trees give us a hint that this, in fact, is a landscape that was not just appreciated by people historically, but also influenced and changed. And we can still see the results of that change today within the composition of the vegetation. So these two circles on this aerial photo here highlight, you can see there's two patches of darker forest. And the trees that you're seeing there are pine trees, white pines. And white pines are one of the first trees to colonize open space after that space has been abandoned. So if a field is cleared for crop production or as pasture for animals and then abandoned, the first trees to grow there are going to be white pines. So in New England, oftentimes when you see white pines growing sort of in clusters, you can hypothesize that it may once have been an open field. And that is in fact the case with both of these clusters of pines. They correspond with late 19th century farmstead sites. So this is in the center here, we have a LIDAR image. LIDAR is a form of remote sensing. It just means LIDAR, or light detecting and ranging. And what this image is showing is the surface features of the ground. So you can see here, running down the left side is a waterway. This is just a stream that runs down Lester Hollow. But then you can see there's a cellar hole sort of near the center of the image. And then the signatures of stone walls and small former roads. And the two photographs on the left, the one on the top shows in the foreground, you can see there are some large rocks. These are the remains of the cellar hole or the foundation of a farmhouse. And then the one on the bottom shows a completely flat area of the forest delimited by a stone wall. And when you find an area in the forest that's completely flattened, it means that it was once plowed and cultivated. And so this would probably have been a garden for the house that's located directly adjacent to it. In another part of the same site, again, we can see on the LIDAR image in the center, the signatures of stone walls, which you see photographed on the upper left, and of a cellar hole photographed on the lower left. And you can see that's me standing in the cellar hole. It's a very significant structure. So this area was farmed in the throughout the second half of the 19th century and into the early 20th century. And of course, the European agricultural and landscape management sort of paradigm was much more impactful on the landscape than that of the Native Americans who lived there previously. But they too had lasting influences and impacts on the landscape. And that's still visible in some places in terms of the composition of vegetation. So this is not a wild or natural place. This is very much an anthropogenic landscape that's historically been occupied by and supported human populations. So this brings us to the question of what conservation is for, what it's all about, what is in fact being saved or protected or restored when conservation is carried out. Is it wilderness or nature? Well, we can see that the very ideas of wilderness and nature are quite problematic. It's arguable whether there's even such a thing as wilderness or nature. Is conservation trying to restore or protect a previous state of affairs or a current sort of snapshot of how things are? If that's the case, how do we determine sort of what we're going back to or what we're maintaining? How do we call this particular moment the baseline when we know that things have changed in the past and things will continue to change in the future? Is it biodiversity that's being conserved? Maybe so. At the beginning of the 21st century, the idea of biodiversity hotspots was coined and then instrumentalized by different large conservation organizations. This map, which is just taken from the Wikipedia page on biodiversity hotspots, shows the different areas of the world that were proclaimed hotspots based on a number of different criteria, including a really high proportion of endemic species, and also a high rate of habitat loss. But this is just one particular way of looking at the problem, and it serves particular agendas. Is conservation about protecting resources? If so, for what, for when, for whom? Are we talking about natural or cultural resources? Is there even a distinction to be made between what's natural and what's cultural? And then, of course, there's the question of whether it's about just sort of the materiality of the landscape exclusively or even at all, as opposed to, say, more abstract or intangible things like values and ideas and meanings. So when I've been talking about, the traces of humans that we can see on the landscape, these have all been physical traces. But in fact, these landscapes might be just as invested with spiritual or aesthetic values or ideas or meanings as they are with physical changes. And so these things are sort of better thought of as cultural resources, which have to do with heritage and identity. And they don't leave physical traces on the landscape. This can cause problems when conservation, when protected areas are being established, because if there's no physical evidence of humans having lived on a certain area of the landscape, conservation organizations or the state can often say, you know, there's no proof that there are indigenous inhabitants here that have a long history, so the land doesn't belong to them, so we're going to claim it for conservation, or for that matter, for resource extraction or forestry or what have you. So there's a sort of a bias here toward physical and material change. But in fact, landscapes are also places that that are associated with knowledge and beliefs and entire ways of life. And those things themselves are very important for achieving the goals of conservation, because people act in specific ways based on their value systems, their knowledge, their economic needs, et cetera. And so if you want people to protect the landscape, that's often achieved or most effective when certain values are sort of built into their way of doing things. And so this just is to say that conservation is very much a political process and a political sort of realm of discussion and debate. What people choose to conserve and why is arbitrary, by which I don't mean trivial. I just mean that the reasons that people have are specific to their worldview. And they could be otherwise. It depends on who you ask and what their motivations are. And the very concept of nature itself is also political, as well as culturally and historically specific. What counts as nature is not something that we passively discover, but it's constructed based on how we know, what we know, what we think we know, who stands to benefit, etc. And so that's why I claim that biodiversity is an artifact. It's something human made, both in a real sense and in a conceptual and ideological sense. So we don't have much time for discussion, but what I want you to, or hope that you'll think about as a result of everything that I've shown you, is how this is relevant to ecological change and the climate catastrophe, which we're all confronting in different ways and to varying degrees. So if anyone wants to make comments about that or ask questions, we can maybe spend a few minutes doing that. But otherwise, you can just sort of take this with you and maybe ponder it or think about how it's relevant to your own interests. Just for the sake of transparency, I just want to show my references so that makes it onto the recording. And then if any of you want to get in touch with me because you're interested about these things and want to know more or want me to suggest further readings or anything at all, please feel free to reach out. That's my email address, my personal email address, charlesbarstow@gmail.com. And you can also get it from Antonella if need be. So I will stop sharing, and if anyone has comments or questions, please feel free to jump in.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Charles. It was very interesting. And I have a little question that is not little, I think, but it's very important. I think that it's very interesting your idea of the political rule of conservation. You saw the Arc of Taste project that is a strategical project of our university. What do you think about this link between the Arc of Taste and the political aspect of conservation? Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, that's a great question. So I think the most straightforward way to start to answer that is in terms of the idea of tradition, which is something that's really foundational to the Arc of Taste and also to other slow food projects. This idea of traditional knowledge, traditional foods, traditional landscapes. And traditional is not a neutral word, just like nature is not a neutral word, or wilderness is not a neutral word. Even forest is not a neutral word or thing. It's something that's created and has specific connotations and whose meaning changes from context to context. So tradition is a problematic idea. It can be used toward very good, praiseworthy, positive ends, and it can also be used to justify pretty abhorrent actions or political agendas. We're seeing that a lot right now in the United States, obviously, with different people have different ideas of what this country's tradition is and which aspects of that tradition they want to highlight, which parts they want to maintain, which parts they want to change or get rid of. And so that's a really political issue. And so that's the case also for traditional food and the Arc of Taste. So the question is, you know, what is it about the tradition that we think is important, whether for culture or for well-being or for conserving different ecosystems or agro-ecosystems of the environment. And so I think it's a question of just being very specific in each context about what tradition means and why it's good and why it might in some cases be an obstacle to achieving what we want to achieve. And I'd say the two important things to remember about tradition are, one, that it is it's invented. So many things that we consider traditional would be considered totally novel to people a generation or two ago if we were able to ask them. And related to that, the second point is that tradition itself is sort of the raw material for innovation. So innovation and tradition should not be considered mutually exclusive. They should be considered very closely related. So yeah, I think, I don't know if that answers your question directly, but I think that the tradition is sort of provides a link for thinking about culture on the one hand and the conservation of quote unquote nature on the other. And it just happens to be that slow food does that through, through agricultural landscapes and ecosystems.
Yes,
so, yeah, I agree. That's what I would say.
And all depends from context. It's a very è una grande tematica quella che stai affrontando.
Yeah, it's definitely I sometimes feel like I've bit off more than I can chew, so it's a question of trying to be specific and follow specific strands, because there are so many ways in which to approach these topics, because they're very broad.
Yes, broad. Yes. There are any questions? There are much and more compliments, but questions from our participants.
Like I said, if anyone, you know, thinks of a question later, and this also goes for people who are watching the recording of the talk,
yes,
please feel free to get in touch. You know, if you want to follow up, or if you're interested in these topics, or even about more practical things, like, you know, what do I do after I graduate from Pollenzo? Like, you know, I'm happy to give people my perspectives. I mean, I'm not an expert on any of it. That's why I'm studying these things. But I can sort of tell you how I've gone about things, and if that's helpful, then that's great. So please, don't hesitate to email me for any reason.
Yes. Then thanks a lot, Charles, because you see, there were also. Yes, there were also some participants. It's very interesting, your topic. Then thank you.
You're
and,
very welcome. Thank you.
See
thank
you,
for
you
having
in
me.
Pollenzo, I hope.
Yes, I hope so.
Ciao.
Okay. Ciao a tutti.
Arrivederci.
Grazie.
Grazie.